Retirement Rocks, Canadian Boomers Invest in Life. We're having back co-author Heather Compton, who's going to tell us how much is enough. How much do you really need to have a rocking retirement?
Actually, John, I want to take us back to your book, Findependence Day, talking about financial independence and the starting place for this whole exercise being set a date. Pick a day by which you say, I'd like to have financial independence by age 50 or by age 55 or by age 60. Making a declaration like that makes you make all of the little decisions along the way that help you achieve it. For example, you say, well, should I have the, $5,000 vacation, or should we go on a more modest vacation of $2,600, and then that difference could go towards my financial independence day. So when you have a date in mind, you make decisions along the way that lead you towards it, that draw you towards it. But in terms of how much is enough, people are often looking for, Heather, could you just give me a ballpark, just give me an easy number? And one of those easy numbers that's often used is, well, it's 20 times what you spend in any given year in order to have a 30-year retirement and die broke. If you want to leave an estate, then you probably need more like 25 times. So now we focus on, so what do you spend? And we can look at three different levels of spending. One is the Eeyore life that says, all right, I can feed and water me and put a roof over my head, but I'm not having any fun.
Kraft dinner and cable TV.
And on the other side of that spectrum, your believable version of the lifestyle of the rich and famous, I call that the Tigger life. And I get to travel every year, and I get to have a new car every 4 years, and I get to do this.
And eat out in fancy restaurants three times a week.
Eat out at fancy restaurants, join the golf club. If you really think that you want the yacht or the villa in France, for most of us, that's outside of what our normal realm of possibility would be anyway. Then I would ask people to focus on, because again, 20 times that number and 20 times that number are very different
results. Take an example. If you have a $100,000 lifestyle, according to your figure, you'd need
$2 million. If I want to spend $50,000 a year, I need $1 million. If I don't have any source of government revenue and no private pension.
So $100,000 is $2 million, and
exactly,
et cetera.
So depending on that lifestyle and being realistic about the lifestyle, and don't forget, you won't have mortgage payments. Ideally, you've gone into the parent protection program and there's no kids still on
the payroll. Well, this is Malcolm Hamlin's point, that Canadians spent so many years paying taxes and mortgages and
yes,
children, that they're so used to living on almost nothing
exactly,
after tax.
Exactly. Now we can probably have a better life than we believed. But it's also defining for ourselves what is enough. Do I really need the big trip every year, or would I be perfectly happy with the big trip every second year? Do I really need a new car every, 4 years? Or I'm not a car person, so a car every 10 years is okay for me. Not so much for Dennis. But deciding those things that really give your life value. I had a client who lived on a $2,000 a month disability income, and she had two indulgences. One was good red wine, and the other was expensive bubble bath. And I used to tease her that she should be drinking the bubble bath and bathing in the wine for what she paid for the bubble bath. But for her, those were her divine indulgences. So decide for yourself what makes for a rich life for you. And not the point being to retire with a rich life, not just to retire rich.
Now for you, just having extra income, because you're creating income, whether it's from book royalties,
yes,
or speaking gig, whatever,
yep,
that makes a huge difference.
$1,000 a month, be that from a defined benefit pension plan or from government sources, saves you anywhere from, let's call it, $200,000 to $250,000 in the retirement pot. So if I can create some income stream, that means that much less savings that I need to have. And I think many of us in retirement should and will want to become serial entrepreneurs. I get to deduct what I spend on books, my internet connection, my newspapers, and other things I use to stay current on information in my field. Deductible business expenses. As an employee, you don't have those. I was telling you about the fellow at the market who travels around Mexico in the winter buying garden pots for his stand at our garden market in the summer in Calgary. He's deducting all of his travel expenses throughout the winter, because he's legitimately is buying inventory for his business back in Calgary for the summer. So there's lots of ways to create a rich retirement that don't necessarily mean a bigger retirement pot.
Thank you very much, Heather Compton, the co-author of Retirement Rocks.